ITV2, a free new channel available on digital, terrestrial and cable TV. Call now.
Now the music, news and fashion of the 70s in the End of the Century show.
It's yesterday once more.
Remember me as a good thing.
Goodbye to change. Goodbye to change. So me, cause you know that you can.
The 70s, what a great decade that was for me and my old band Slade. But it wasn't all glam rock and platform shoes. No, there was the miner strikes, power cuts, the three-day week, and the winter of discontent. We still managed to have some fun though. Here moving into his new house in Solihull is my old mate Dave Hill. Only he would move next to a girls' school. This programme is all about the news, the music and the fashion that made up the 70s.
There are some things you can't cover up with lipstick and powder. But I heard you mention my name, can't you talk any louder? Don't come any nearer. My vision of you can't come any clearer. Oh, I just wanna hear girls talk.
Jeff, how are you feeling, in fact?
Bloated.
We really feel that in the summertime, there should be a normal standard of decorum.
So would you say you prefer to see your young ladies coming in shorter skirts?
Well, I'm always an advocate of shorter skirts, yes.
You've opened a sex shop this morning. What does that mean in simple terms?
We have opened a surgical store.
Don't see anything wrong with it?
I don't agree with it.
Well, everybody to his own taste, I think.
Everything you do sell and do market is connected with sex.
You could say that, yes.
This is why, of course, it's called a sex shop.
All right, yes, fair enough.
To be blunt, would you supply equipment or advice to homosexuals, lesbians, masochists or sadists?
I wouldn't know.
He did the mash.
He did the monster mash.
Birmingham's most controversial statue ever was King Kong. He arrived in the bullring in 1972.
The really good thing about it was everybody had a firm opinion of it. It wasn't a piece of concrete with a hole in that was supposed to be aesthetically pleasing or something. You either liked it or you hated it.
It's terrible. We're represented by the bull here. That's enough without that monstrosity.
All
right. All red eyes.
It was here for 6 months and the city council decided by one vote not to keep because they only had it on loan.
Mike Shanley bought King Kong for £2,000 and set up the King Kong Car Company.
The first day was there, busloads of people going past, pointing and laughing at 7 o'clock in the morning. It was absolutely fantastic.
Mike eventually sold the statue to another businessman, and King Kong is now languishing in an open-air market in Edinburgh.
I tried to get him back and we were setting up this classic car business here, and he wouldn't sell it for £100,000 now, because he sells King Kong T-shirts, King Kong ice cream. It's a centre of attraction. It was just a replica of a big gorilla, and it was made for Birmingham, and it should have stayed here.
But if the 70s are remembered for anything, it's for being the decade of the strike. Everyone seemed to be out or on the march.
Together we'll stand, divided we'll fall. Come on now, people, let's get on the ball, because together we will stand, every boy, girl, woman and a man.
This postman had carried on working during the strike, and his colleagues had sent him to Coventry. A year later, they still weren't speaking to him.
We've been told that they're not prepared to forgive and forget. Does that strike you as funny?
It certainly does. That's very bloody mind to be like that.
I mean, after all these years, we've always been friends together, and all of a sudden I start being like this for no apparent reason.
Things came to a head in 1972 when the miners went on strike. Soon there was no coal, unless you scratched for it in embankments like this. This was the Siege of Salt Lake. Flying pickets were used for the first time to great effect. They were brought in by the busload from all over the country.
We don't want to ring with
you. Arthur Scargill was the leader of the Yorkshire miners. He led the pickets as they tried to shut down the Saltley Coke Works in Birmingham.
We are finding new partners for wages. A little bit of solidarity.
John Burroughs was one of the flying pickets brought in from Derbyshire.
We spoke to them, we gave them all the arguments, and we were successful in getting a few of them to turn round. The majority of lorry drivers were not prepared to stop, and the idea of pushing and shoving at the gate entrance was to get bodies in front of the gates physically to stop the lorries from getting through the gates.
In the end, thousands of engineers and car workers joined the siege, and the sheer force of numbers closed the works.
The cheer that went up when the gates were closed and the lock was put in position is again a very vivid memory. I mean, I think everybody expected the following day for them to be open.
The trade unionists of Birmingham proved a point that once they stand solidly together, nothing on earth can move them. A magnificent feeling.
This was one of the more bizarre signs of the times. No coal meant no power. Industry went on a three-day week and people had to use their initiatives.
We were very, very poorly paid. We were working extremely long hours in arduous conditions. That was something that I believe was not very well recognised by the wider public.
The next year saw one of the worst ever mining disasters. 14 men were killed and 16 injured when a lift cage crashed down a 1,400-foot shaft at Markham Colliery in Derbyshire. 4 months later, the miners went on strike again, and this time they were to bring down the government. The three-day week was back, power stations were closed, and the public were urged to share baths to save energy.
What do you think of the idea?
Quite good.
Are you going to do it?
Oh, yes.
There's about six of us at home using it.
No, but using it at the same time. You bath with somebody else.
You jest.
Is there going to be any argument over who sits which end?
I don't think so. Long as I don't get by the taps.
Oh, well, I'm shocked,
strangers, yes.
Oh, well, you wouldn't want a stranger, would you?
You never know.
No.
Prime Minister Ted Heath called a general election and lost. The miners won a 35% pay rise. You can get it if you really want. And so it went on. In 1974, there was a baker's strike. It was a bit like the war. You had to have your card stamped to get a loaf of bread.
I think it's shocking. And I think this government is as weak as water.
It's something to pass the time away, isn't it?
The teachers went on strike to protest about spending cutbacks. And the pupils stage a sit-in to protest about the teachers being on strike.
And how long are you prepared to stick it out?
As long as it takes.
The silliest strike of all really was a storm in a teacup.
The men are used to drinking tea in assorted sized cups, some of them as large as a pint apparently. The management found they were having to subsidise the tea kitty money by about £5 a week. So they thought they'd introduce the standard British teacup measure. Every man would be entitled to this much tea poured into whatever size mug he wanted. But the men didn't like the idea. A lot of people from the outside looking in will see it as a completely ridiculous English sort of a strike. Would you say that was true?
Yes, I would say that.
The men have agreed to return to work, and there's going to be an immediate meeting with the stewards to determine in which way the tea will be catered for and paid for. You can get it if you really
want. The government set a 5% pay limit, and that sparked the winter of discontent. There was no petrol. It was a hard winter, and when the snow came, the roads weren't being gritted. people had had enough.
End of strike! End of strike!
They were all locking up, every one of them.
I mean, all these strikes, I mean, they're absolutely ridiculous, aren't they?
They talk about considering the fact of the poorer people. They don't consider all they're concerned about their own livelihood, that's all.
And then there was British Leyland.
It was quite exciting days when they used to have the mass meetings. It made me laugh the one year you went in there and there was a platform there with speakers on and I was playing that song, You Won't Get Me, I'm Part of the Union. Union man, I'm wise.
The controversial shop steward, Derek Robinson, became known as Red Robbo.
For people who didn't actually work at Longbridge, I think he was a hate figure, because they read the articles in the paper about him and programmes on the television, and it wasn't a true picture of him at all. To me, he was a hero.
There were disputes over hours, pay, overtime, washing up time, even puddles on a shop floor because of a dripping roof. The unions blamed poor management.
Nobody knew what if there was going to be a strike, obviously, until there was a vote. So you didn't really know, and then everybody would wait for the show of hands, and some of the people there, they didn't know what to vote. They used to look around and if there was a majority of hands, their hands would go up. If there wasn't, they'd keep the hands down. That was led, some of them up there.
Everybody here wants to work!
Yeah! And you're not going on strike!
No!
The majority was 2-1 to support the shop stewards and ask them for a reasonable claim.
We want the right to work. That's all we've got to say. We've all come here to work.
To ignore the changing mood of the people inside the factory would be stupid, and we are not stupid, and that's why we've taken the decision we have.
In the end, Derek Robinson was sacked.
That's where he wants to go, Russia.
Russia!
Go away, get away back to work!
Despite a campaign to reinstate him, the car workers refused to go on strike to support him, and Red Robbo was doomed. He lost his case at an industrial tribunal.
Like 24p, you can bring your weekly wash down here, scrub it, boil it, and do whatever you want to do with it. And that's been the way of things for the last 45 years. But no more. The last remaining public wash house in the Midlands is to be scrapped.
And what are you going to do when it closes down?
Well, the only thing we'll have to do is go back to the Stone Age washing in the single get automatic. I've got an automatic washer, an automatic dryer, an automatic ironer. My washing's still better over here.
When I wake up in the morning, love, and the sunlight hurts my eyes, and something without warning, love, bears heavy on my mind, then I look at you. And the world's all right with me. Just one look at you, and I know it's gonna be a lovely day.
301 Radio Trent. The weatherman forecasts for our area today, dry, and there'll be long sunny periods.
In part two, Cluffy, the Great Crossroads Wedding, and party time for the Queen's Silver Jubilee. Seemed
impossible to be.
Oh, that was a hell of an unpleasant drive.
You're not from round here, are you?
For a more comfortable lifestyle, look to Swindon, home of the Honda Civic.
Summer 2000 at Lumpolly. Book your holiday now and pay next year. Kids' places are free, or we'll pay you. And there's 10% off, plus free insurance.
Summerfield's Price Check has great offers every week, like half-price seedless white grapes.
Didn't we get a bigger bunch?
No.
There's a Colgate toothpaste that cleans so deep, it will leave your mouth feeling incredible. Its ultra-fine bicarbonate of soda reacts with an incredibly refreshing gel, releasing oxygen bubbles so that nothing feels like Colgate Sensation Deep Clean.
The Lynx Effect.
Do women always have to spend hours taking their makeup off?
Not with new soft facial cleansing wipes from Nivea Visage. They remove eye makeup, cleanse and tone in just one easy step. Could anything feel softer on your skin? Well, maybe. New convenient soft facial cleansing wipes from Nivea Visage.
Do I use it more?
No.
Has it gone up in value?
No.
Am I 18 again?
No.
Have I moved to a dodgy area? Has it suddenly turned into a sports car? Have I ever had an accident? No. So, am I happy my car insurance has gone up? No.
What? Did I phone Direct Line?
Yes.
Did I get a good deal?
Yes.
Would I like to be 18 again?
Yes.
So for easy, low-cost motor insurance, better talk direct to Direct Line.
When I grow up, I'm going to be a chauffeur.
I'm going to be a travelling salesman.
I'm going to be a pilot.
What?
For a more enjoyable lifestyle, look to Swindon, home of the Honda Civic.
The Midlands was hit by a wave of bombings and letter bomb alerts from 1973. Everyone was on the lookout for suspect parcels, but no one was prepared for what happened in November 1974. Twenty-one people were killed and 162 injured when bombs went off in two busy pubs in the middle of Birmingham. Maureen Lord had gone for a drink with her fiancé at the Mulberry Bush.
I don't remember hearing it. It was just like the lights went out, really. And then the next thing I remember was actually sort of flying through the air and then landing and Ian calling to me.
Maureen had severe internal injuries and nearly died. Her fiancé was protected by his coat and was saved from serious injury.
Was in intensive care for 5 days. I remember bits about the intensive care. I remember Prince Philip coming to see me. I remember having the last rites. My own parents, I remember arriving and my dad turning away crying, and I couldn't understand why he was crying because I didn't realise how seriously I was injured at that point.
The Birmingham Six were jailed for life in August 1975. They had always denied the pub bombings. They were cleared after spending 16 years in jail.
Well, I like to think I'm not bitter about it. It's too many years on now.
1976, this sign landed a Leamington man, Robert Ralph, in jail for contempt of court. There were furious protests outside the prison, and trouble broke out between rival groups. On appeal, a judge said he must stay in jail.
Mrs. Ralph, how do you feel about the judge's ruling this morning?
Just sick inside to think, you know, that he could go this far with an Englishman who's fighting for his people and his rights. You know, I never dreamt that this judge could be so hard.
Open the car door, Neil. Open the car door. Open the car door.
If anything happens to Ralph.
I hope Roy Jenkins is proud of himself today. Hang him, hang him!
Ralph was released 46 days later on health grounds.
What exactly is going to happen now to the sign that's outside your house?
Well, that stays there. I mean, I was released, and as far as I was concerned, no conditions laid down.
Amazingly, 9 years later, he admitted defeat and sold his house to an Asian family.
Money, money, money.
Well, I think it's terrible.
We were too old to fiddle with the other prizes.
You think it's bad?
Yes, yes, for all us old people, because we don't know what we're doing.
If I had a little money, it's a rich man's world.
In the summertime, when the weather is hot, you can stretch right up and touch the sky. Sing along with us.
Eat, drink, and be merry. I like it.
Spaghetti Junction was opened in 1971. It would have been known as the Gravelly Hill Motorway Interchange. But for this man, who was then a journalist on the Birmingham Evening Mail.
I went to this press conference called in Birmingham by the Ministry of Transport with great pride to announce its proposals for a huge motorway interchange on the north side of Birmingham. This was going to be Birmingham's main link with the M6 motorway. And I remember being very impressed by all these artists' impressions. This looks like a plate of spaghetti, you know. I described it like that in the story I filed for the Evening Mail. And it appeared on the front page that night under the headline, Spaghetti Junction. And the name stuck.
Ready, steady,
go! That's it, that was unnecessary. That was
unnecessary. Hold tight.
Thank you.
especially to see Meg.
It's overwhelming, isn't it?
It is overwhelming because we've all worked for so long for this day. It's really, you know, like being married.
The great sporting character of the 70s was Brian Clough. He took Derby County to the top of the First Division, then resigned in 1973.
It's not letting anybody pinch me, come
on. No. I'm not watching.
Can you tell us why you resigned?
Brian, can you just ask...
That is the last question. Thank you very much indeed.
In 1975, Clough took on Nottingham Forest and took them to the top. Look at this. Life's begun. Nights are warm and the days are young. On May the 4th, 1979, something happened that changed our lives more than we could possibly have imagined. Maggie Thatcher came to power.
Where there is discord, may we bring harmony. Where there is error, may we bring truth. Where there is doubt, may we bring faith. And where there is despair, may we bring hope.
But that's another story.